Good morning. Welcome to Hope Sanctuary. We hope you will get a blessing in today's service. We welcome the Reverend Brown today to give us a wonderful message like she usually does.
Thank you.
God would teach us.
So we may learn to be more compassionate, so we may be taught how to be more loving.
We gather here where Jesus would teach us.
The wisdom to choose forgiveness, but we're all holding the garbage. We're not committed to both, so we may speak to all.
We gather here where the Spirit imparts wisdom.
So we might know how to share grace, so we can learn to welcome all to this day.
Thank you.
Alone, we are welcomed into a family. Forgiven, we are sent to serve.
Fed, forgiven, restored, and loved, this table is our constant reminder of God's presence in our lives, of God's grace, which makes us new in every moment. Thanks be to God.
Yeah.
music ministry. Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, the 10th chapter, verses 25 through 37. I know this is probably a very, very familiar text, and I'm hoping that God would reveal something new to us today. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And he answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he said to Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" And Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place where he saw the man, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him, and he bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. But he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three, do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber?" Jesus asked the man. And his reply, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Oh, most good and gracious and loving God, we all came out of the home this morning where we did not have to worry about food or shelter. We did not have to worry about damaged goods, mold, water, all of the issues that our brothers and sisters are facing, oh God, in Texas. And so we ask, oh God, that even as we pray that these words would meditate upon us, we always have others, the neighbors that you talked about in this text, also in our mind's eye today. So bless and keep us as we open your word and hear from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, the text says, who is your neighbor? Who is your neighbor? Let's see. How technologically I'm inclined. I just closed it. Go figure. Whatever. I was trying to look. I had the definition for neighbor, but I can remember it. It's someone that lives close to you, next door to you. And the second definition is someone that is nearby. And that's going to become significant in this text. A neighbor is someone that is nearby. So not necessarily someone that is just living adjacent to you, but also someone that just happens to be nearby. And so, you know, our God is something. For the last 4 weeks, we have been inundated on the news with hate. Have we not? I mean, pure, unadulterated hate. I don't know what it is. Hate, how do you spell hate? H-A-T-E, love, L-O-V-E. Somehow, the word Jim played Scrabble, the words, those first three letters got totally screwed up. And somehow, somebody replaced that L for an H, and that O for an A, and that V for a T. But we got the eternal God that's going to shake it on up.
And did God shake it up last week? He took all that hatred, didn't he? God, the Father, Mother, and Holy Ghost took all that hatred off the news. He took it all off of our radar because it had gotten so crazy. Do you remember as a child you all were playing and you thought you were having a good time and your parents finally said, cut it out. Sit down, enough is enough, because you were about to destroy something? God said, enough, let me remind you of who's in charge. Let me remind you. And I also think it's kind of ironic, you know, slavery over in 1863, and we celebrate Juneteenth. I don't know if you're familiar with Juneteenth. Well, guess what state it was that didn't tell its slaves that slavery was over? The state of Texas, hello. God just came and decided, I'm going to take my power, and I'm just going to bring this water because you all have lost focus. And all the love? Do you see all the love that has been poured out? I was on vacation and I was still amazed as I would come in late at night, and I love Anderson Cooper, so, you know, that's a given. Watching, I mean, people that were traveling. You know, one guy that got his brother's truck, this truck looked almost like a, it was huge. And he brought it in, and his friend, and people that came in their boats, even not the first, they weren't the official first responders, but they were the first responders that got the call from God. One guy said, I was sitting in my house with my daughters, and there was no way I could sit here. And I took that 3-hour drive because God compelled me to move into action, to help my neighbor, to help my neighbor. And in this text today, I mean, it's amazing. It's a good fit. People, God is saying, who is your neighbor? So let me give you a little history. Can I give you a little 2-minute church history? Okay, so this text has several characters. It's got the robber, the robbers. It's got the victim. It's got the priest. It's got the Levite. It's got the Samaritan. And it's got the innkeeper. 6 key people. Now we know that the person that helped the man was the Samaritan. But you may recall as we roll back to the first part of our Judeo-Christian history, right? God chose the people of Israel, said they were chosen, not frozen chosen. I think that was funny, frozen chosen. But chosen, they were elect. And so that becomes a sense of, I mean, we should tell our children that they're pretty. Tell our girls that, and tell our young boys that they're handsome. But at some point, our heads can become pretty big, and the people of God thought that they were so perfect and privileged that they did not have to deal with other people because God had elected them and chose them. But throughout the Levitical laws, we read how Micah says, What does the Lord require of you? Do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Throughout the year of Jubilee was a year upon you're supposed to forgive folk of their debts and forgive folk of all the wrongdoing. But the people of Israel thought that just meant their tribe and their clan. That I should forgive a Jew, but I can't forgive a Gentile. I can't forgive any other tribe that's out there because we're so elitist and we're so elect. And so Jesus is now, we fast forward, and Jesus is now with the Jews, and they're still intermingling with other people, and they still want to know, this lawyer is saying, do I really have to consider the Samaritans and these other people that are not of my skin color and not of my culture, don't look like me, don't pray like me, don't think like me, that aren't as smart. Are they really the neighbors? That's what he's saying. Jesus, you need to qualify this, because I hope you're not asking me to like people that don't look like me. Now, I want you to think about something. Circular. There are, you know, there are different levels of hierarchy, unfortunately. We've got different levels of economics in this country. So within the scheme of Judaism, imagine the inner circle is the priest. And the next outer bring all the Levites. So we had the priest that saw the man first. Now keep in mind, it says they were coming from Jerusalem to Jericho. And Jerusalem is in the valley or in the hill. Where's Jerusalem?
On the hill.
On the hill. So they're going down the hill. They know they had church. Huh? What you gonna do when you leave here today? They were leaving church. And the priest comes down that inner circle. He comes down and it says he went on the other side of the road. Okay? The next layer is the Levite. So the Levite comes down, sees the man, goes on the other side of the road. And this is the way in which the Jews kind of categorize within their culture. Priests, Levites, then after that were all the other Jews. And then the circle after that would have been the tax collectors and the sinners and the robbers. And the final layer would have been the Samaritans. Probably Jesus starts with the priest, the guy. He then goes to the Levite, and the Levite, other side of the road. He skips the commoners, you and I, and he skips us and goes to the Samaritans. Now keep in mind, the Jewish people hated the Samaritans. It's biblical. If you go and look in the Gospel of John, when Jesus is going and he meets the Samaritan woman at the well, it says he went through Samaria. Most Jews went around, you know how we go around 695. And I don't know if this, you know, the design of 695 was so you didn't go through black communities. 83, you don't go through no hood to get on 83. I'm just keeping it clear and real. That's what we do. And so Jesus goes right to the juggler with them. Catches them off guard. The Samaritan. You know the history of the Samaritans, right? The two tribes of Israel that were the first ones to not listen to God, and God let them be victorious. The Assyrians become victorious over them. And when you become victorious over people, you split and you take the best of them to your tribe, and you let those that you seem to be insignificant to stay in their country, and you begin to put in all the other tribes of people that you conquered, and those Jews begin to intermingle. It wasn't their fault. They were basically enslaved, and they became the Samaritans. But it's the Samaritan that went down the road, and the text says that he went to him. He didn't avoid him. So that's your neighbor again. Your neighbor, in order to get to your neighbor, sometimes you got to go and meet them. There's this great crazy commercial where a woman comes to a new house with a pie, and she goes, hello, I think it's like for insurance or something. And she goes, I just called to see if you're weird. You know, and it tells you how people are really thinking on the inside, and she finally goes into the, I mean, this is kind of the type of thing that's going on here. The Samaritan goes to his neighbor. And this is a Jew that he's going to. Okay? Sometimes the people that we oppress the most are the ones that bring us and remind us of who God is. Follow me? It was the woman at the well that she brought more people to who Christ was. And so this man, the Samaritan, not only goes and heals the man, gives him oil, but he also takes him to an innkeeper. Now keep in mind, this was the hood. If you do your Bible study, this text was called the Blood Road. Because this was the road that you traveled, right? From the city down into the suburbs, and along this road is where a lot of people were beat up and robbed. So the church folk coming down from Jerusalem knew where they were going along the road. So who do you expect to see on Blood Road but people that had been injured, disenfranchised? Because that's what happened on that road. And when we get on that road, we're not supposed to have blinders on like a horse. You know, we don't see anything but what's in front of us. But you have ears and you can hear what's going on around you. Jesus said, that man, the Samaritan. And it's crazy because when he asked the lawyer, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man that fell upon the road? The lawyer says, the one who had mercy on him. He hated Samaritans so much he couldn't even save the Samaritan. The one, them, those people over there. So that's us, because we're the church. We all sin and fall short of the glory of God. And sometimes we just need a wake-up call. Your neighbor is whoever is next to you. Turn and look at your neighbor. You got a neighbor? This is your neighbor. Who's going to Giant or who's going to the grocery store and eat here? Am I the only one? All right. Your neighbor is that person behind you in line. Don't just sit there. How easy to get that People magazine? I saw that with Angelina Jolie is doing. Turn around to the person behind you and start talking to them. I thought it was late today because I just came from vacation. We had to go to Enterprise and drop off the car. And I had to take my significant other. We had an issue with cars. So I thought Enterprise opened at 9 and it opened at 10. Oh my Lord, I said, Lord, you got it worked out. So we're in line trying to be the first one. And we started talking to them. Well, man, where are you going with that person? We began to have a conversation. You never know who just needs to have a good word. You never know what house somebody is. Some people are in the store running out of their house for refuge. You never know the people going through. Just God bless you. Have a good day. You know, just treat everybody like your neighbor. But so that's all the Lord requires of us. He ain't telling you and me to put on no cross. He said, get on the cross. He said, get some stripes. I don't think anywhere in Texas says you got to have 8 licks. What's the greatest commandment? What does the Lord require of you? Is that easy? And we've got to put our culture, the stuff I learned around my kitchen table, and the crap you learned around yours. We got to put it to the side. And remember what we learned at this table. And what happens is our family tables supersede this table. That's why we had cars running for tourists in Europe. We got cars. That's why we're more concerned about a statue than we are about people. Don't let the table that God prepared for you in your home supersede the table that He prepared for eternal life. Oh, God is good. Companies and individuals, our church, every church is helping. And let us not forget that these folk will need us for years to come. And I will be in Atlanta next week, 2 weeks. I remember after Katrina, when families were displaced down in the South, and I don't know if we had here in Maryland or not, but they're coming. And we've got to receive them. Let's forget about war. Let's forget about war. Because we're talking, and God will build it and see what God will do. Oh, will He bring a hurricane? He will bring water where there's never been water. God is reminding us that He is God. And He's fed up with us. Fed up. But this week, we have confessed our sins, and I pray that we will forever remind ourselves that we have so much love on the inside of us to do all of the wonderful things that God has created us to do. I mean, I wish I was close enough. Don't you wish you were close enough? But we are. In our giving. Giving to the Presbyterian Baltimore, giving to other national release efforts that you might be. We've got people that we serve through the self-development of people, through many of our ministries that are impacted by the people that are there. So pray for them. Continue to pray for them as you pray for yourself. And pray for our brothers and sisters that were maybe close enough to go and help and did not. Maybe watching some of the TV news, their hearts have been transformed.
this tale that you all so beautifully sang about is for everybody. The fat, I can say that because I'm fat as ever. The fat, the skinny, the tall, the short, the black, the white, the yellow, the green. Conservatives, liberals, people in the middle, gay, straight. This tale, isn't that fascinating? There is one table that we can all come to. I call it the Mephibosheth table. Regardless of what your feet look like, whatever disability you have, at this table, it does not matter. Because this is God's table. The loving, accepting, forgiving, empowering table. And so I pray that there's a double portion. A double portion today. A blessing to you when we break bread and drink wine and celebrate the Lord's day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us now stand and sing to come as guests invited.
Thank you.
I'd like to add a little bit to what Carol said earlier. Presbyterian Disaster Assistance is the emergency response and refugee program for our denomination. It is dedicated to the long-term recovery of communities adversely affected by a crisis or catastrophe such as Harvey. We support it through our gifts to One Great Irish Sharing and also through donations that is needed for response to specific disasters such as this one. Their response team has not been able to go into the Houston area because there is literally no place for them to stay. All of the hotel rooms are filled with evacuees. They are in the assessment phase, and one of the things they've been doing is reaching out to the presbyteries in the area. And the presbytery that includes Houston reports that at least 18 churches there have suffered major storm damage, as well as many members and pastors who have been affected. If you would like to donate, you may do so through the church. Just put your donation in an envelope and write PDA on it, and we will combine them and send a check off. Okay? Now to the main topic. Paul writes in Ephesians 2, verse 17, "So he came and proclaimed peace to those who were far off and peace to those who were near." The letter to Ephesians tells us that Jesus came to proclaim a peace that is universal. While the earthly ministry of Jesus happened in a specific age and place, the peace he shared is limited by neither time nor geography. As followers of Christ, our call to work for peace begins in our own neighborhoods and extends to the ends of the earth. It is a demanding call, but it is one that Presbyterians at all levels of the church are seeking to follow. Giving to the Peace and Global Witness offering is one way we can be faithful to Christ's call to pursue peace at home and around the world. 25% of this offering stays with our church to build up peace in our community. 25% expands our witness throughout our region by supporting ministries of peace and reconciliation and Presbyterian mid-councils. This would be the presbyteries and the synods. The San Francisco Presbytery matched congregational gifts for refugee resettlement up to $10,000 using funds from the Presbytery's portion of Peace and Global Witness offering. The remaining 50% supports global witnesses to Christ's peace through the Presbyterian Peacemaking Program and the reconciliation work of the Presbyterian World Mission. An example of this is Reconcile, which stands for Resource Center for Civil Leadership, which has been striving for peace among South Sudanese ethnic groups for years. And it is continuing its work, even though it has been displaced from the headquarters that it had in South Sudan. Your gifts to the Peace and Global Witness offering will help to end suffering and violence, both here in our community and around the world. Let us pray. We pray for courage and wisdom to proclaim God's peace in our neighborhoods and around the world. Give us strong voices and generous hearts that we may stand with the Prince of Peace against violence and injustice. Let us join with Christ to work for a world of peace and plenty. Amen.
Yes, God is so good to us.
We have all received good things from God. Now is the time to bring them back with joyful thanks.
And encourage them and allow them to rise, oh God, and to be in their full witness
They were called to this church for such a time as this. We not only pray, oh God, for this church, but we pray, oh God, for the people that this church loves. And so we pray for the Handley family, oh God, with the loss of Bobby, a dear friend of Joan Miller. We lift up prayers, oh God, for Cindy Lawson, who has bronchitis, and for Alan and Alona, Anna and Alona, oh God, who are also not well today. Oh God, we lift up in prayer our brother John Lawson. And we know that there are plans for him to come home on Thursday, oh God. We lift up the prayers, oh God, for every teacher, every bus driver, every office staff, anyone who is going to receive our beloved angels after the holiday. We pray, oh God, for our children, that you would keep them focused, oh God, and allow them to know that it is learning that will give them the all that they need to be the people of God you call them to be. We pray for everyone, oh God, who is homeless and who has been harmed as a result of the hurricane. We pray, oh God, for the end to war and all victims that have been victims of violence because of war. Oh God, we pray for wisdom for our national leaders as we continue to have international tension. We're all trying to decide that I'm bigger and better than you. Allow our leaders all over the world to know that God has all of the power. Oh God, we just ask that you would take the silent prayer concerns that are in our hearts, as well as those that were written down in this book, as well as those that are in our minds, God, that you would take even the ones we remember when we get in the car this afternoon, that you would take all those prayers, wrap them up, and may all of our prayers, oh God, all of our concerns be lifted and blessed. May you turn every burden into a blessing, every trial into a triumph. Allow us, oh God, to know that you are God, and with you all things are possible. We ask that you would bless and keep us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And invite the celebrants to please come forward. This, my friends, not my table. Whose table is this? This is the Lord's table. And the Lord invites each and every one of us to come. Isn't that nice? You don't have to pay. You don't need to have your RSVP card. All you need is a willingness to understand the power of this table, because there is power in the table. I'm going to sit here and hope that I'm sitting there in this place that won't allow. Well, there you go. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and Jesus Christ paid the price on Calvary for you and for me. And he doesn't require much of us, but one of the things that he requires is that we celebrate what happened on the night that he was with his disciples. And on that night he took bread and he broke it, and he said, "This represents my body, which is broken for you." And in the same manner, he took wine and poured it into a cup, and he said, "This represents my blood that will be shed for you." So each and every time we drink of this cup and eat of this bread, we do so in remembrance of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior, until he comes again. And therefore, my brothers and sisters, I invite you to come, as this bread and this wine has been consecrated, that represents the body and the blood of Christ, to give us the nourishment that we need to be the people of God. I invite the celebrants to now come and join me, and we're going to ask those who are able to come and receive the elements. Would you please come? Love divine, our loves accept.
Love your neighbor as